So without any further ado, I'm going to hand it off to the candidates for their opening statements. And
right, there's no testing. Hi, my name is Miso Demko, and joining the Joint Funding Committee was one of my earliest commitments coming to CMU. And from my early days, I felt compelled to do more than just sit on the committee and go to weekly meetings over and over again. And I felt we can do more. And specifically, when I say we, I feel like everyone has to take action individually. And there are great resources at Carnegie Mellon. And I want to utilize those to the maximum and do more. And that's why I'm running with the belief to create an efficient system for financial administration that puts every dollar of student money and tuition towards helping people achieve their interests, passions, and extracurricular life. And I'm running on a platform of social good of three pillars, which are focused around laying out a vision for the campus community. The second pillar is empowering organizations by investing in CMU talent. And the third one is holding both the JFC and student organization leaders accountable. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Shelley Bellisiano. I am a junior studying economics and statistics. Since my freshman year, I have been an active member of the Finance Committee of the Undergraduate Student Senate, culminating in my current position as the Senate Finance Chair. In addition, I have worked with the SBVPF as a two-time representative on the Joint Funding Committee. While in these positions, I have managed $158,000 and am in the process of allocating over $1.6 million more this year alone. In essence, 100% of the overall undergraduate student activities fee. Given my experience, I want to improve the allocation of the activities fee. To do so, I will start the JFC process in early fall to train and educate JFC representatives. This way, representatives will properly aid the organizations they are assigned to. In addition, I plan to create a multicultural fund to assist organizations that wish to host events that would otherwise be restricted under the predetermined metrics. Lastly, I'm a huge advocate for fiscal transparency and plan to make all student government transactions public. Right now, I'm working with current members of the executive committee and want to ensure the longevity of this initiative through bylaw changes. I have 3 years worth of experience in finance and student government. As student body vice president for finance, I would be your guide and your voice. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Gabriella Catch. I am a fourth year student studying chemical engineering with a double in engineering public policy. I was involved with student government my third year under the vice president for organizations working with the collaborative funding committee. I was also the former president of the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers, and I am currently involved with Soul Styles, which is a dance crew under Dancer Symposium. My passion for VP for finance stems from my first interactions with JFC committee during my time as president of SHIP, which is the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers. I gave a presentation to student government in hopes in attempting to appeal for a budget allocation that was given to my mature organization, and there were disagreements with the current JFC policies that I believe that were imposed on us, even though we were established for over 20 years. And I think that that was an issue that that's at that point where I realized the big influence VPF has on organizations, especially financially. And so I come here with an organizational perspective, being involved, being an outsider per se, from student government, where I want to ensure that these organizations continue to contribute to the student body experience. And that's why I think I'm very fit for the role currently. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Frank Schenk, and I am a current sophomore studying business with an additional major in statistics. I am running to be your next student body vice president of finance. I wouldn't say I'm necessarily as qualified as these people up here, but I feel like my vision for what I want to do is a vision for change. During my senior year of high school, I was the treasurer of the student government. I am a current midshipman in the Navy ROTC unit at Carnegie Mellon, where I'm a mentor to third class, or to freshman midshipmen that just came in. Also, I'm an active brother of Sigma Phi Epsilon, where I'm a social chair, where I have to plan events and manage a budget. So I would have liked to get involved in student government. However, I didn't know where to start. I learned about this by seeing something on my Facebook feed that one of my friends saw and was like, oh, I'd run for this. I'd feel like I'd make change. So I decided to run. I feel like we can make this process better by increasing the communication about how to start getting involved in student government your freshman year. For example, I would have joined JFC had I known what that was or how to apply or how to start getting involved. Also, I feel like, yes, we do need to increase fiscal transparency, and we're all lobbying for that. So, but outside of that, I would also be a member of the executive board. And with that, I would also like to increase fiscal knowledge within the CMU community as a whole. I've had several friends of mine get lucrative internships that pay thousands of dollars each summer. However, they don't know how to fill out a tax return or a W-2 to get their tax returns back, where the government's just taking their money. So I feel like if we increased meetings and walked people through taking taxes and learning like real life, they would actually benefit. Also, I would like to campaign by partnering with third party vendors to make special deals for CMU students. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So now we're going to transition into questions prepared by us, and then we'll eventually get a question from the audience again. We'll keep it at Frank, and you guys can sit back again. So the first question for all of you is, how do you think your previous experiences on and off campus have prepared you for being SBVPF?
So as I've said, I have not held a student government position. However, I do not think that eliminates me from attaining the position of Vice President of Finance. As I've stated before, during my senior year of high school, I was the treasurer of the student government, where I worked to decrease cost and increase efficiency and keep a balance sheet that was available to the school. Also, I'm a member of ROTC. The student body vice president of finance is in charge of JFC. They're in charge of managing, training, and leading them. And I feel like with my experience in ROTC, I am best qualified to lead, train, and represent the school. Well, that's a little harsh, but thank you.
Hello, everyone. As I mentioned before, I'm a fourth-year student. I am heavily involved with dance and as well as the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers. I really rose myself up to leadership position up until presidency, which I I gave it up back in a month ago to pursue other positions like this one. And I've had a lot of work experience outside. I also have a job that has helped me manage my time and also be organized when I plan events. And essentially, I think my work experiences outside, such as working for a product and engineering company that I worked, has helped me analyze, figure out how best processes can be efficient. So although I have not been involved with student government, I believe that these experiences, being able to understand different processes along with the education that I have received from Carnegie Mellon, has enabled me to be prepared for this role.
As I mentioned in my opening statement, I'm the only candidate who has already done the duties of the SBVPF in a smaller scale. In my 3 years in student government and my role as finance chair, I allocated $1.6 million, managed $158,000, evaluated hundreds of applications for funds, advocated for students to administration, and innovated to solve problems that students and student government are having and facing.
So what I say about myself is that I'm a very optimistic person, and that's always helped me whenever I see weaknesses or shortcomings in academic life, in extracurricular activities, in social life around campus, is that instead of dwelling on the negatives, I always find a way to have an impact on the positives. And by uniting friends, acquaintances, classmates, always make the positives even stronger. I too am a Joint Funding Committee representative, and I have intricate knowledge of the metrics of the system, how it runs, and working directly with student organization leaders and helping them make their budget proposals. I've worked on this committee since the beginning of the year, and also I'm a Dietrich student. And as a Dietrich student, I've worked on putting together a Dietrich Student Advisory Council for improving our school's activities. And also I'm very involved in social life on campus, and I'm always very eager to meet new people and work with them and just like listen to ideas and advocate for people who don't have the same access to running the system, so to say. And Joint Funding Committee, as we've heard, is a system that's kind of been tucked away. And by working with students, I like to put it at the forefront and work with the students to make this something everyone's involved with. Thank you. So like you said, and like the name implies, the Joint Funding Committee is a committee, which implies some sort of leadership from above, which is what we're running for, and also committee members. Now I think committee members are actually the core of the committee and should be more involved in decision making. And currently there's a bit of an imbalance in power between the Vice President of Finance and the committee members. And what I'd like to do is revise the role in a way. That starts with metrics. The metrics are private information. And I like to institute a public system of metrics that everyone has access to. As President of Finance, I like to send out our committee members as agents into the field, so to say, who work with organization leaders with training, but providing them help putting the budgets together, and not just reporting to committees on a weekly basis, but having an active role in how we allocate funds.
Sure.
Right. And I believe Vice President of Finance is one of them. Yes.
So there's a question about that committee and how you will serve on that and bring initiatives to that committee.
Oh, sure. Yeah. So by including, first of all, I'd like to increase the number of committee members. And by hearing more voices, I have more substance to bring to the committees, or the executive committees of president and vice president, et cetera. And also, in a way, I would be in charge of the committee, but also as a voice between the two, so bridging a gap in a way. And by bridging that gap, I would like to make sure that more perspectives are heard. The appeals process is something that is brought to the executive branch in the very end. I think we should keep them involved from an earlier point, so that communication flows transparently and with less back and forth, which will improve our efficiency. Yeah.
There are currently discussions being had regarding the role of the VPF in regards to the relation to the other members of the executive committee, specifically in the expenditures that the other members have. What I mean by that is that currently the SVP and the VPO and the VPF can spend their JFC allocations almost however way they want. And there are changes in place that may be coming that would make it so that the VPF would have to approve all the transactions before they take place to make sure that the expenditures are appropriate. One specific thing I plan to do on top of that is to make sure that the transactions and the expenses are made public through publicizing the bridge transactions, but on top of that, I want to create documentation that would release a digestible form of the expenses, because the bridge can have confusing, you know, comments and descriptions. So making them digestible and also released in a more frequent setting, so perhaps weekly or as they come in, as I'm doing in the Student Senate right now.
Can you repeat the question just one more time so that I know exactly? Right. Right. So I'll be very broad and also try to go into depth on some of the initiatives that I think are very personal to me and that CMU should be talking about more. The three are diversity, also mental health and awareness, and as well as professional development. And I take these all three into consideration to heart, and I hope to, being, you know, VPF, being able to talk about these issues with the SBP and the SBVP. And so one of the things about diversity and that I truly value is that everyone has their own story to share. You probably might not know my story, and if I told you, you'd be so surprised. Like, I'm from, you know, Los Angeles, come from this really Hispanic family, and I'm pretty sure maybe you just don't, you know, have never met a Hispanic person or have never interacted with someone of my background. But I'm also like the first in my family to go to college, and that's something that I always truly want to share with other people, because they get to learn from my perspective and I also get to learn from other people's perspective. And I think just being able to share that helps other people kind of connect and, you know, grow as a person to be able to go into the real world. And so one of the other things I want to talk about is professional development. Everyone here going to school, they want to make sure that they're leaders in their own industry. And so one of the things I really want to advocate for is making sure that the students here can have, you know, the communication skills, public speaking skills, making sure that these students can be leaders in their field. And mental health awareness, we've talked about that a lot. And so one of the things I hope to do is also make sure that we continue to do those initiatives.
As SBVPF, I would bring new ideas, because I was not involved in student government beforehand. First of those would be partnering with third party companies. The University of Florida student government recently partnered with Uber to get half off rides Wednesdays, Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, from 10 p.m. until 3 a.m. Now, The student government said they paid in their student newspaper $46,000. I don't know if that's per year or per semester. However, that sounds like a pretty good idea for CMU to do. It would cut down on drunk driving, sexual assaults, and crime after hours. Now, I'm not saying it would be that expensive, because CMU's student population is a whole lot smaller than the University of Florida's. So even if we raise the student activities fees by like $2.50 a student, if that, it would be worth it, because you would make your money back in one ride. Also, I would like to initiate spending Dynex and Plaid cash off campus at more stores. Currently, we're only able to spend them at a certain number of restaurants. I think it's 5 different restaurants. I would like to expand that to most of Oakland. Most of Oakland already accepts Pitt's dining dollars and Panther funds. The software, I think, works the same, and it's just about partnering with them. I would like to also start having this. I would like to also have, I would like to try to eliminate what people call the CMU bubble. I would like the student body to be able to reason with people with differing viewpoints without getting offended or saying that people are just ignorant because they just disagree with other people. I would like us to really start learning from other people's perspectives, because if we start keeping people down and just think our current way, that's not what college is about. College is about expanding our viewpoints. Thank you.
Thank you. And for the third question, coming back,
So if I'm not mistaken, back in the fall of 2012 or 2011, a referendum was put forth to both the graduate and undergraduate students to raise the student activities fee by 25%. Because it hadn't been updated in a while, and there were so many more organizations than when it was set originally, and it was not being able to keep funds with the left. So what I would do is I would put forth a referendum this year, because every 5 years seems like a decent goal, to do the same thing. And it did pass the undergraduates, and it did not pass the graduates. With that, if the undergraduates want more funding and the graduates don't, then the increased funds from the undergraduates should go to all the undergraduate programs. That is what I would do, because we are paying a lot for this university, and I really don't think $15 is going to hurt anybody. Thank you.
So one of the things on my platform is doing a kind of like a research and development for organizations, meaning that each student organization will have somewhat like a financial model. So one of the plans that I want to do is kind of use people, typically VPF can hire two assistants and have these assistants audit, essentially creating some sort of financial model that dates back up to 2012 to ensure, to kind of track and see how each student organization is spending their money and seeing whether, like for example, a full allocation of let's say $800 for transportation is actually being used towards that. Because there are some organizations that receive more than others that are not being used as fairly, and so I think that would also ensure fairness.
I feel like one of the things we can do is just start the JFC training earlier and have the discussion about metrics and the impact of the activities fee earlier. What I mean by that is that currently the JFC convenes in the spring, and the JFC reps go and speak to 10 organizations without really having the understanding of what it means to allocate the money. And I think that they're also getting a very limited perspective on the impact they have on those organizations. By starting the JFC process earlier for the selection of the representatives, it would give them the opportunity to go and actually speak to organizations in a wider capacity, which would then allow them to make more educated decisions when we're looking at their budgets. I think that we need to start looking at what the organizations value and making it more transparent and clear as to what we want to fund and what organizations really need. And once we know that, we can evaluate them and make more appropriate decisions regarding what to fund and what not to, compared with what we have done in the past, which is just zero things out because we didn't know what they were.
So although it's been treated, the budget, as a stagnant sum of money, it actually is not. The JFC holds a central financial role at Carnegie Mellon. And I think we should use that role to connect national and local donors to invest in student organizations. The organizations and events happening on Carnegie Mellon's campus span a number of fields, from launching rockets, building lampposts, constructing new technologies in cars. These activities span more than our campus boundaries. This involves the entire world. And I think for that reason, we should be looking to sponsors in the world to invest in CMU's talent. And that will be able to pool in more funds.
For our final question for all of you, going back, so what is your opinion of the current funding allocation process, and what kind of changes would you like to see made to it?
So first, just to outline it a bit, the funding allocation process has a few steps. It starts with the student orgs, who work internally to put that together. Then the committee members, representatives, bridge that gap by working with them and reporting to the Joint Funding Committee. And then the Vice President of Finance runs the committee meetings until all the budgets have been approved or denied, or basically altered in some way. And could you just repeat the question just to make sure I answer specifically? Sure. So First, I'd like to increase the number of committee members from about 20 or so to a higher percentage that reflects a greater population of the Carnegie Mellon community. Second, I'd like to make sure that the committee representatives have a more active role in the work they do for the JFC. This starts early in the year by reaching out to organizations, not just ones they're assigned, but just showing a general interest in the activities happening on our campus. And then when it comes to budget proposals, I think every organization should have some more training sessions to understand what a budget proposal impact, what the impact of a budget proposal is on fiscal opportunities the club has for the entire year. Because often a little setback can have drastic consequences for the club years to come. And also in this allocation process, I like to revise the metrics. It's caused great concerns among organizations, particularly the interpretation of metrics. And I think as a financial institution, we should not leave room for interpretation. We should have public metrics that are applied consistently and fairly, and I will be accountable for those as the Vice President of Finance.
Can you repeat the question one more time?
What opinions do you have on funding process? What opportunities do you think there are for growth?
Okay. So to clarify about the JFC process, in more, you know, broad sense, the representatives meet with the organizations, then the JFC convenes, and that information comes back and is discussed, and then Senate and GSA approve all of the allocations in one meeting as a slate. Something that I would like to revise in that process is the beginning. The JFC doesn't really do anything as a group until spring, until after the budgets are due. By starting earlier, we get to offer the training, as I've mentioned earlier, which would allow a greater depth of understanding. I would also like external JFC office hours, somewhat like TA office hours, are being held now, in the sense that I feel that 4 to 5 JFC reps should be in any given office hour that would happen maybe biweekly, or once every 3 weeks, where organizations would be able to come in and make their budgets with us. And that would help give proper information and answer any questions in a more direct way. I would also like to distribute more content about the JFC and the allocation process. A lot of organizations don't know how to use the budgeting module. They don't understand, you know, how to delete categories. I don't even think you can. But like, they ask those questions because they get really confused, or how do they change something and they have to delete it and then put it in. It's very complicated, the website. And information about that should be provided. I would also like to change the metrics and have greater discussion about them. So one thing is the cultural food. There is no cultural food metric. There was one in the past. I feel that we need to bring that back in order to support the cultural and ethnic groups on this campus, given the current political climate. And I want to redefine and increase the uniform metric, because right now it's very inconsistently applied.
Yeah, so I think one of the opportunities for growth here is a collaboration between COSO and JFC. I think from an outside perspective and my conversations with other student organization leaders is that some of the JFC representatives are not as passionate about their own organizations. So it makes it difficult for them to kind of have reach out into some sense, and so there's a lack of communication there. And I think for choosing, having, you know, selecting JFC representatives, I need to make sure that these representatives are passionate or somehow interacted with the organizations that they are representing, because at the end of the day, we want to make sure that the organizations can also contribute to the student body experience. And so one of the other things that I really advocate for is also using outside resources. And so that would mean probably potentially helping organizations find outside sponsorships, whether that be, you know, with the connections I have within Pittsburgh, because I have been able to grow and expand my network through the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers with not only companies, but also nonprofits and other organizations. And I think being able to have a connection or reaching out to these people, figuring out ways, you know, aside, we can get these organizations more funded.
So
So first thing I would do is I would increase knowledge about the JFC. Because like I said, I came in here freshman year, and I wanted to do something with finance since I'm a business major. I just didn't know anything about this. I would have joined, so I would increase the knowledge so that way first year students and even older students know about this to join. Next, I would increase the number of JFC representatives so that way each representative will work with a limited number of organizations and they will stick with those organizations throughout the year. This would ensure that the JFC representative is really able to understand the needs of each organization, so that way organization leaders can base their budgets on what they need and not as much as what they want. Because in the end, organization leaders should be able to justify what they need to need for funding. Because and I would also start training earlier in the fall semester, so that way the JFC representatives can reach out to their prospective organizations that they would be assigned each earlier. And then I would have the JFC representatives work with the organizations that they're interested in. So if you played sports in high school, I would like you to be assigned to the sports teams because you would know that a sports team doesn't need uniforms every year. They need it about once every 3 or 4 years. But they do need, for example, the soccer team would need soccer balls every year instead of a soccer jersey every year. So that is what I would do to improve the process.
Great. So now we're going to go through. I'll ask two individualized questions, then we'll open it up to all of you guys to ask questions for each candidate. Okay, so starting with Frank again. So how do you plan to specifically increase awareness of the JFC and encourage your applicants?
So from what I'm aware, each freshman class coming in each class still maintains a Facebook group that everybody joins in. So I would join that Facebook group and post in it. And I would also more gear my marketing of the JFC to the Tepper School of Business, because that is something that probably most business majors or economic majors are mostly interested in, is working with numbers. Next, I would just put flyers up on campus and in the residence halls, because if you don't, it's easier to get the freshmen involved because, or at least have them have knowledge of the system, because they live on campus, almost all of them. And if we start the knowledge sooner in the beginning, then they don't have as many questions and they're not as upset senior year or in the later on when they don't really know like where their money is going and stuff like that.
Thank you, Gabrielle. An issue mentioned in your platform is diversity. So I wanted to ask you specifically, how do you plan to increase diversity of JFC and why is that beneficial?
Yeah, so diversity is very important when it comes to choosing members within JFC. You know, you want to have undergraduates to graduate students, potentially PhD students if they want, so you can understand the different organizations that encompass within CMU. You also want people who have been involved with different organizations or have been interacted with different organizations, because that really helps us understand as a committee, okay, how does that contribute to the CMU community, and also just making sure that everyone is very fair in how we're allocating these resources. I guess that's pretty much sums it up, yeah.
Shelley, can you explain what you mean in your platform by mid-year fund, and how do you think that a mid-year fund would benefit cultural events, and how do you plan to structure the process and fit it in with the regular JFC budget process?
So mid-year funding exists so that organizations throughout the year, when they face, you know, unexpected costs or new initiatives or have new ideas, they can come and get more money. So currently, Student Senate has a special allocation fund, SDC has a fund, GSA, DOSA, and the SBVPO with the collaborative fund. The JFC provides budgets throughout they budget for the next fiscal year. So organizations get one lump sum that's already allocated to line items and costs for the next year. If there's anything that comes up, that organization can apply to mid-year funding. And that's a great benefit to those organizations. In regards to the cultural fund that I plan to create, I think right now the JFC and student government as a whole has sadly undervalued culture on this campus. What I mean by that is that we have a $600 food metric, and a lot of people in the JFC ask or say, oh, you know, if we want to raise that metric, we would be taking it away from something more technical. And that's fair. There's a limited amount of money. But we, I feel, have not considered how important these cultural groups are and how advertising, or not even advertising, just how bringing awareness to these groups can be beneficial for the campus as a whole. I feel that as a compensation for the metrics and in order to help promote diversity as a student government, a multicultural fund can exist in order to facilitate new programming or even old programming, recurring programming, that would help foster conversations and discussions regarding what these organizations do and how they make CMU CMU.
Sure, I'd love to. So touching on what you spoke about, the school culture, I think from school culture, we have to decide our values, and values lead to laying out a vision. The vision we have for Carnegie Mellon in the short term, the end of this year, the next fiscal year, and years to come. And I think that's a responsibility we take on now. And to answer the question of what I mean by vision, I think there's a sense of competition for dollars instead of cooperation. And that's the mindset we've been instilling into student organization leaders, which leads to various concerns like gaming the system, meaning taking metrics and interpreting them, or filling out cells, little like budget cells that favor a certain allocation of funds. And whoever knows the system better probably games it. And this is all because of the a sense of competition that's been instilled. And a sense of cooperation would unite organizations that have a similar nature, for example, a cappella groups. Instead of having only one receive a piano and everyone else having to wait a year or two or more, we give resources to the Council for a cappella organizations, who then make sure that everyone uses the resources fairly evenly. And this will also make sure that the JFC can provide enough attention to more campus-wide concerns, because we don't have the specialization or the required knowledge to really understand how organizations of certain nature, especially more specialized ones, how they operate. So in that case, councils would decide how to spend those resources. So I bring up metrics to the extent that metrics are like the operating block that the JFC relies on. It's as much as a block as, say, how the committee members reach out to organization leaders, as much as how committee members interact in our weekly meetings. So the metrics might have come up a lot in the discussion. They're not by any means the central focus of my platform. My platform is more about empowering the student organizations with funding, including outside funding, and using the Joint Funding Committee's power as a central financial institution on campus run by students to help provide more donors and bring in more sponsorship. Metrics will just ensure that that money that we acquire using increased efforts on the committee members' parts will be more consistently and fairly allocated between clubs, so that concerns afterwards don't always have to go to appeals, but the system can be healthy and working properly from the start, saving time and committee members' effort and energy to invest in growing campus life in other ways that they see fit.
I think that fiscal transparency is important because we are students. Student government is kind of obviously made up of students that, you know, are in charge of a very large sum of money. It's thousands and thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars. When we're responsible for this amount of money, when one person at many times is in charge of that amount of money, it makes it very easy to say, oh, $20, oh, that's not that big a deal, right? Let me use it on food or for dinner or whatever I want to do. It doesn't, in terms of fiscal transparency, I feel that because we are students and because we are using money that students need, especially with the concerns of the JFC where organizations are fighting for a very finite pool of money, I feel that a great accountability needs to be placed on fellow students who have a lot of autonomy in that spending.
So one of the, I think, BPF has the ability to hire two assistants. My plan for that was essentially using these assistants in the fall to kind of hand manually data mine. So that involves going onto the bridge, looking at each transactions and kind of building off like, okay, how much was spent over this, you know, this, I guess, over this time period, but how much money did JFC allocate for that time period? Was it officially used, or how much of it was used, and what amount was left over? And I think being able to do that and have kind of a financial model that basically I'm planning and making sure that these two assistants can do that throughout the fall, so that when springtime comes around and we all convene, we are able to kind of look at that and kind of generate some idea and also use it for future references to see how much potentially and predict the amount of money that a student organization should be receiving at least, or how, and taking into consideration how much they're growing on campus and things like that. Yeah.
Thanks for your final question. You mentioned wanting to partner with third-party businesses to expand places like SIX and other campus-bound funding. So how do you plan to use the position of BPF to go about that?
So being VPF, you're on the executive committee, and that shows that the students voted for you, and they trust you to try and carry out your vision or their vision through you. And so while being VPF, it might not necessarily be the duties of the VPF, such as like chairing JFC and allocating funds and stuff. It's also just as important because you're part of the executive branch, and you're trying to make, and you just want to make student life better. And making student life better is the average student just needs to, like, if they want to go, people have complained about limited dining options on campus. Well, if you want to go to Chipotle, like, just go to Chipotle and use your Dynex instead of getting Gaio, or go to Panera Bread instead of ABP. Like, I don't know. It would just improve student morale and make campus better. Like, I would want that. I don't know who wouldn't.
Okay. On that note, we're going to open it up to the audience to ask questions to the candidates. So we'll ask you to pass the mic on before we pass
So I think this question that I have was touched on a little bit earlier in regards to the cultural organization. But as student body vice president of finance, what is your philosophy on distinguishing between grad and undergraduate organizations? Specifically, do you believe that because graduate organizations rely extremely heavily on social events and programs, that they should be granted additional flexibility in their budget, where they could use at least half of their budget for things like food? Because if you are president of a multicultural organization and you are also a graduate student and you only have an operating budget of like $2,000 and most of your constituents only go to social events, how do you think it's appropriate for graduate student organizations to be treated different from undergrads in that sense?
Thank you for your question.
We're giving greater flexibility to grad student bodies.
Thank you for your question. Yes, I do. I would be in for that as long as you would update your budget and get the request approved beforehand, so that way, or just let your JFC representative or the SBVPF know beforehand within, I would say, probably like a week ahead of time that you want to allocate this to food and such, so that way you could get a bigger turnout, because we all know like students only go to stuff for free food most of the time. Yeah, I would probably be for that.
I think that, you know, there is a difference when you say that if majority of your events, if like your core mission is say, bring your members, it involves having these social events and having food, and that's what makes them come. Because I have been a part of an organization that, you know, when you order food, that's the only way they'll come. And so I think one of the things to consider is that to ensure that we fulfill that. So yes, I don't want to say flexibility, because I think that every organization should be treated with fairness. But if you're saying that that's how your organization will contribute and foster, you know, help bond between other grad students, then yes, I think there should be some leeway to some extent. So yeah, that's my response.
I know there's a difference between equality and equity. You can have a $600 food metric that is applied to all organizations, be they undergrad, grad, cultural, or, you know, sports, athletic, anything. You can have a $600 food metric applied to a bowling group and the same metric applied to a cooking club. Does that make sense when their needs are completely different? I don't think so, right? In terms of undergrad and graduate, they have different needs. I think greater conversations have to be had for more robust discussion, because this is a very different system that may need to be applied and implemented. And so I would want to have that discussion and encourage it if I am VPF.
So your question of food, I think through my experience attending...
Well, it's not just food, it's...
Right, and just like
in general
attention for graduate events, I would say. Do you agree? Like the issue is attracting and just like having resources allocated towards graduate events as much as undergraduate events?
It's not necessarily the monetary value.
Right.
It's the ability to allocate more money in your budget to social events, regardless if it's like, it might be food, it could be other things. But graduate students have less time, so they only go to social events.
This ability goes back to your representation of graduate students in the committee. There's an overwhelming number of undergraduate committee representatives, and I think one of the things that I spoke about was increasing the number of committee members to better reflect the different populations on campus. That includes, very importantly, graduate students. So one thing I would push for is to have a greater number of graduate students on our committee who can voice those concerns and actually have the ability to act on them.
So I kind of want to follow up on that. My name is Daniel Geer. I'm the president of the Graduate Student Assembly, and I'm the one who helps recruit people, the graduate students, for the JFC. And I was wondering how you might work with my successor in the GSA to increase the graduate student representation on that committee.
So first, I'd like to understand better, through my experience, the different roles that graduate students and undergraduate students have on campus, and the different needs they have through their involvement in extracurricular activities and besides academics. And my personal experience relates to undergraduate needs. And I could learn a lot from you about, I guess, the graduate students and what campus life and needs are for them, what the different social events that we talked about, like what the purpose is of those, and what's the driving force behind those. And I think under the current metrics, which was a question for me earlier, these metrics would be revised together with executive committee to make sure that they address different students' needs fairly and consistently, given our populations on campus.
Can you repeat the question?
Yes, the question is, how would you work with the GSA president next year to increase graduate student representation on the joint funding committee?
So there's currently a cap on the amount of members that are supposed to be on the JFC. It is at maximum 10% of the amount of groups that apply. There's also supposed to be a ratio of graduate to undergraduate representation on the JFC. I'm not exactly sure whether it's being fulfilled right now or in the past, You're shaking your head, so yeah, I didn't think it was. I think that there needs to be greater interaction, as you've said, between the undergraduates and graduates and the VPF and GSA. We need to start having greater conversations and collaboration. I understand that undergraduates tend to go to undergraduate organizations and graduates tend to stay in their fields as well, but that doesn't necessarily excuse the lack of information that a JFC rep has. I think that they need to go and speak with graduate students as well. And I think that we need to have more forums and conversations that collaborating with GSA can make a huge difference in representation.
Yeah, I think one of the goals I would do is definitely connect with the GSA president to further understand, you know, what is your vision for currently for GSA, and basically understand your mission, your goals. Also participate in some of the events you guys have. I think it's really important for someone like myself to understand what kind of events you know you're holding, and at the same time being able to experience that, because that would also enable me to kind of just understand and understand why you are part of the organization you are and get to know other graduate students. And yeah, I think that would also help me kind of bring in, hopefully, with the connections I make throughout going to these events, have them come and join JFC committees.
Hello. So I would work with your successor to improve the communication so that way more graduate members apply to be on JFC. And to the point I made earlier, I would assign graduate JFC representatives to graduate organizations and undergraduate representative JFC members to undergraduate organizations, because in my opinion, that pairing would best know each organization's need and be able to, as our previous question said, allocate funds for different reasons should needs arise.
Yeah, so my question is related to organizations. So the first half of it relates to, so a lot of VPS, they come in with an idea and with a plan, but I think they often forget that they're clients at the end of the day of the organizations who requested those funds. So the first half of the question is, how do you plan to not only take your platform as you have it now, but also to mold it to what student orgs actually want to see? And the second half of that is student orgs have, over the years, pushed more and more to remove all metrics and to not have them at all. So I want to know your opinion on, do you think that would be good or bad, not only for a single organization, but for all the organizations that apply?
Thank you for your questions. So I came in with a, per se, I have a platform, but I would also say it's flexible in that I'm able to adapt very well to different situations. So if, for example, if I'm doing something but the people I'm serving don't want that, I would change and comply with what they want if it's within, if I'm allowed to do that and if it makes sense to do that. Can you repeat your second question, please?
Yeah, it just relates to the metrics that are currently used. Organizations have in the past have brought up removing all of them, so no metrics would be applied at all for any organization. Do you think that's a good idea or a bad idea, and if so, why?
So first of all, I would say that if metrics are removed or not removed, it would be the same for each organization. So one can't have it removed and it would stay on another. It would have to be the same. I'm against that, because then organizations are just getting money, but they're not necessarily being kept to spending it on what JFC and the VPF approves it to be spent on. Because, for example, sports teams don't need jerseys every year, but they request funds for jerseys every year. So if there were no metrics, we wouldn't necessarily be able to track what they spent it on necessarily as easy. However, I am open to, if certain needs arise, there should be able to be flexible metrics pending upon the situation and circumstances.
Yeah, so I believe my platform does encompass the organization's viewpoints. I think one of the big important advocates I'm for is the collaboration between COSO and JFC. Having JFC early on kind of interact with COSO and understand the organization's needs, not only within like the renewals process, but as well as making sure understanding how an organization functions. I think that's a training that JFC committees representatives should know. And to answer your second question about removing metrics, it's definitely a consideration. However, I think one of the issues is that it could also become chaotic, because typically we use metrics to figure out how best to be fair to everyone, and that is also to be discussed within JFC to figure out how each metric should be assigned. But in terms of, I would probably look into it, but I can't really go for it.
So my platform, I have 3 points. One is restructure the JFC process. Another was fiscal transparency. And the last point was specifically listen to your needs. I have met with organizations for the past 3 years, and I've heard a variety of issues, concerns, and feedback that does change depending on the organization that I speak to. I've realized that the problems that organizations face also change year to year. Right, with what's happening right now with culture in the United States and diversity. That's something that organizations wouldn't have necessarily had as much of an issue with in the past. I think that the JFC needs to adapt, and also the VPF and the platforms may need to adapt as new issues arise. In regards to the financial component of that, a lot of the time, people think that finance is, you know, cold, objective, it's just numbers. I think something a lot of people forget is that there is an emotional component that should be included and incorporated in that. These allocations and budgets truly impact the way that organizations may be for the next however many years. It really does affect the culture on campus. When it comes to metrics, it's difficult. In finance committee, we do not use metrics for the requests that come in. We are fairly binary. We fund by line item, so we will usually either fund the full amount, none of it, or if there's a ratio of grad to undergrad, we may consider that. When you don't have metrics, it becomes arbitrary in regards to how much you fund, if you do not fund none or all. So how do you decide whether to fund 200 or 400 of something? You really can't be consistent in that type of decision. So I think it's important to have metrics, but I think we really need to consider the emotional component and the impact that these metrics have on the different organizations.
To answer your first question about the platform, I think every plan should be flexible to include different issues as they arise, different campus circumstances. But my platform, with the three pillars of cooperation among clubs and organizations of similar nature, and maximizing the number of students who are benefited from every dollar spent, empowering organizations through increased funding when possible, and holding both organization leaders and the JFC accountable, I think is a solid starting point for any further changes in plans as to how the JFC will run. And to answer the second question about metrics, initially the name might even imply like an algorithm that where you just put numbers in and the allocation of funds is not debatable. It's just like, that's how the metric says it is, that's what you get. But through experience, it's been proved over and over again that that's not how it works, and that there very much is a human factor in determining how much money organizations receive. And I think the human factor is clearly how a committee works, but also leads to bias even when it's not necessarily recognized. And I think that, first of all, making the public metrics public will increase the amount of scrutiny we're able to receive on it. And this input will be able to help us to improve it. And also, currently, there's the budget proposal section And then between then and the committee deliberating, the next step in the process is mostly appeals. And by working on the process in between, I think making it a smoother transition between budget proposals and communication while the committee is reviewing hundreds of budget proposals would be a beneficial change to the metrics.
All right, if you don't mind, one more question, and then we'll do opening or closing statements, okay?
Okay. So how would you, each one of you, what is the major way that you would make your presence felt to the everyday undergraduate and graduate student at Carnegie Mellon as student body vice president of finance?
You asked to make my presence felt?
Yeah, how would, so if you came into this role, how would me or anyone as an everyday student at Carnegie Mellon feel your presence and what changes would you bring to the role? Right, so how would I feel you in charge of this $1.5 million fund?
How would you embody the role of student leader?
Right.
Sure. So I would say my main objective isn't to increase my presence or feelings of my presence, but I would work on increasing the presence of organizations and what they do on campus, that activities and efforts of students that takes months and weeks to put together doesn't just end up posters on a bulletin boards that people pass by, but these are events that fulfill different students' extracurricular interests and passions. So that's one presence I definitely work on making bigger, and that would be through funding, which is what my role is in charge of.
I feel like right now the VPF is kind of hidden away and not very visible by anyone outside of student government and student organization leaders that are directly involved with the JFC process. And even then, they don't really have a lot of access or information to the individual in question. To make the VPF more visible, I think comes with two things. One is showing that they care, or that I care if I'm elected. And the other is showing that through actions. So by having a multicultural fund, for instance, it's showing that I'm listening to student issues, and organizations can then apply to that and see that I'm actually working to take their voice into account. Having forums for discussions also does that. Having JFC members meet with organizations, and not even just the organizations they're assigned to, but have greater conversations in that sense will allow more exposure of the JFC and the VPF. And then showing that will then in turn make it so that the student body knows we exist and knows we care, and then they know that there is a VPF. So if that answers your question.
Yeah, I agree with the first part, that what Shelley said, maybe the VPF is not seen. I think for me it would be also making the efforts to attend some of these events that are being funded. You know, go and try to meet people, kind of like just other students that not necessarily are within my social circle, and kind of just and be happy and contribute and look at how an organization is growing, contributed to the CMU experience. And I also think it's just the matter of potentially maybe if that means, if I can't, there are over 300 organizations, and you can't do that, well, I don't know, maybe, let's assume that every organization has an event that's like 300 events. I personally probably would not be able to attend every single event, so maybe that would mean having people within JFC committee go attend an event that they're representing. So then they further understand also how their role is contributing to this organization and why they're representing, and kind of become more passionate about it. So, yeah.
I would put a little bit different twist to your question. So yes, our number one job is to fund student organizations and to better enable them to carry out their missions and their goals and their dreams and bring students together. However, to improve the life of the average college student, we need to, as a whole, student government, both Senate and executive executive committee, need to take in the advice of the students who necessarily aren't involved in student organizations, but we need to hear their complaints, not just through organizations, but as a whole student. So, for example, people have been complaining about using dining dollars only on campus or select locations for many years now, but still nothing has changed. So I don't know if that's necessarily due to student government not acting or because Cullen Art just won't allow that to happen. Another thing is Ubering and staying safe. Like I said, I will push to make us partner with Uber, because then if you're studying in the library and it's like very dark outside and you're kind of scared to walk home, like you can get home safely. Or if you're out and you're over 21 and you have a few too many to drink, you can get back to safely. Also, we just need to increase. So we learn a lot here at Carnegie Mellon, a lot of useful things, but we also don't learn a lot. I would say we learn a lot, but we don't learn real life skills such as filling out taxes. And maybe I'm the only one up here who just doesn't know how to fill out taxes, but I mean, I'm 20 years old and I got a W-2 from my summer training with the Navy this summer, and I sent it to my dad because I had no idea what to do with it. So maybe hosting guest lectures or having faculty members come walk students through filling out their taxes would be well and represent the average college student.
I would just like to clarify about the role of Senate and what they have done this year and in the past, just because I am a member of Senate and I'm very involved and aware of what they do. We have had a lot of initiatives with dining and with improving the campus life as a whole. We actually, a few years ago, managed to change it so that originally Dynex would be part of a two-week system, and then it would reset like the blocks, and Senate had a role in changing that. I even managed to speak with the director of dining, Pascal Petter, and managed to make it so that the upgrade your block system was implemented. That wasn't a thing before. I mentioned it to them. So Senate has done things in regards to that, as well as we're currently looking into the 3% tuition increase and financial aid on campus. We don't just represent organizations, we also represent students. That's really what the main focus of Senate is.
So just to go into this whole increase by 3% tuition, so I looked it up this afternoon. I don't know if this is quick information, but the Bureau of Labor Statistics states that the inflation for January and February at 2.7 and 2.5% this year, so that 3% is about online as to why CMU, because a dollar next year is not going to be worth a dollar this year.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and begin closing statements, starting with Frank, and then we'll go down the line, 15 minutes.
Hello, I want to thank you for tuning into tonight's debate. You have a very important choice coming up this semester, this year. My number one goal, I said, is to fund student organizations and maybe increase funds by holding a referendum and allowing a 25% increase like they did in this fall of 2011, and able to better fund student organizations, because right now, currently, all organizations are not receiving the total funds that they need or want. Next, but I also really want to be part of the executive committee to make the average student CMU life better, because whether you're in a student organization or not in a student organization should not be a hindrance upon whether the elected officials serve you or not. I stated with my positions to try and get Uber rides half off and improve Dynex off campus and hold regular meetings to help people fill out their taxes during tax season. That would fulfill the goals that I feel are most needed on this campus to make the student life better. I'm a member of the Navy ROTC program, and that takes a lot of time each week, and that just shows that I have the drive to say what I want, or to accomplish what I say I want to accomplish, and this is what I want to accomplish. So I look forward to hearing from you if you have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you to everyone.